Welcome to Circuit 42.
Circuit 42.
The one-stop location for all things geek. This episode is brought to you by our sponsors, Dragon's Lair San Antonio and Gotham Newsstand. Sit back, relax, and most importantly, enjoy another episode of Circuit 42.
Circuit 42.
But yeah, you're actually one of my favorite artists, so I'm really glad that we could set this up.
Thank you very much, champ.
I remember the first time I saw your work, it was not my favorite X-Men story, Zero Tolerance, but your work stood out.
My first X-Men run wasn't either wasn't among my favorite X-Men stories. It was a complicated moment, so it was at the end of Skull of Death run on the book, and the beginning of Joe Kelly's. So it was in the middle. So one of those guys was leaving the book, and the other one was about to start. And I think that they both weren't in the moment with more energy.
It was definitely a weird moment because, like, you know, they just have drastically different writing styles. And I think that the transition must have been really interesting, to say the least.
Yeah, they went very interesting. That's right, because overall, because Scott, when I started to draw the book, Scott was very sympathetic with me, and he asked me if to add everything that I had in mind for the book, any characters. I remember that I mentioned here that the only condition I have for working in the book was to having Chan Chi, the master of Kung Fu, because I love the character.
Oh, dude, Chan Chi is so awesome.
Yeah.
So are you hoping they put him in, since we're getting Iron Fist on Netflix, I'm hoping that we get Chan Chi. That'll be freaking amazing.
Well, so the things that I was exciting. I was really excited those days with the possibility of working with the characters and him. So, but anyway, so there was the day where Wolverine looked very weird.
Oh, when he had evolved
the bananas in the head. So was so weird and was so strange. But it was very fun because I love Scott. I love Joe Kelly. I was with him just a couple of years ago in Buenos Aires in Argentina. And he's such a great guy, so I would really love to work with him.
I got to meet Joe very briefly at San Diego. It was when he was, it was with the Man of Action guys. So you had him and Siegel and Joe Casey. I tricked Joe Casey because I told him, he didn't have his sunglasses on. And I said, oh, Joe, can I get a picture of you? Why? He said, well, you don't have your sunglasses on. And he said, oh, okay, and he puts it back on.
They were the John Turks of those days at Marvel, so there was the white teeth generation, because every time that they Scott, even that particularly the action guys, that's Joe Kelly and all of them, every time they was pictured in the Wizard, I envied their smiles because they were so bright, the teeth looked so white that, you know, I envy them. So it was so funny those days. The late days of Bob Harras at the front of the company, and the before the coming of Joe Quesada, those was very, very fun times to me, artistically.
Yeah, because you were there right in the transition. Now,
I've been in the transition of everything. I've been in the transition of everything. The transition of the X-Men, the transition of Marvel Comics. I've been writing in all those complicated moments. That's right.
Yeah. So before you move on, because honestly, with what we've talked about so far, we might as well just make this part of the show. But before we continue, for those who don't know, those five people, those five comic fans, who are you and what do you do?
Well, so I'm an artist from Spain, from Europe, and I'm someone that I'm not quite different from any American fan from an older generation, because the American comics started being published in Spain 10 years after they were published in America. So technically, I'm younger than the John Byrne, Chris Claremont, George Perez, so all those names so familiar for any other any comic fan in the world. But I belong to this generation in terms of the knowledge about Marvel Comics and DC Comics, because as I said, so those comics were published in Spain 10 years after they were in the States. So I grew up reading the same comic books as those big names did, but I came in the industry later than them, obviously. So I'm someone that love superhero comics. I love comic as a medium in general. I grew up reading European comics from Uderzo, Giro. I grew up with Moebius, Carlos Jimenez, and those European names, Krebax, Manara, even Corbin in American.
Richard
Corbin. Richard Corbin was a name that has nothing to do with superheroes. But then I discovered superheroes from basically Fantastic Four, issue one, number one. And I was hooked on comics immediately. I was hooked on superheroes. And I grew up reading Jack Kirby, John Buscema, Gil Kane, Neil Adams, Roy Thomas, Al Buscema, John Buscema. And, well, so it's a love superheroes from the beginning.
So something like looking back, like your work and like Joe Madureira, those were the comic artists of my childhood. Like mm-hmm. you, Madureira, the Kubert brothers. And you had, all of you guys had this energy, you know, that you really didn't, that while there were a lot of great comic artists before you, this just work that like popped and just stood out. What do you think it was about your work, about your work and, you know, a lot of the people from mm-hmm. that kind of circle? What do you think it was that made it have that much, that kind of energy?
What happened to me is, I think basically that I wanted to, you know, for an American fan, to break into comics is complicated, but it's something possible to imagine. But try to think about a Spaniard, a little kid that read superhero comics, and back in the 70s, the United States were so far from here, that it was almost impossible to think that one day I can be one of the artists of all those wonderful books. For me, I never had the idea. It wasn't a dream either. So I never had the idea of one day I can become an artist for Marvel or DC. So the day I started to work for those companies, I basically put all the energy that can be contained in my body in the pages. So I've been doing this every moment because it was a so impossible dream that the last thing I wanted is that lose the chance of doing my best at any moment. And this was personally, but I can talk about the other guys, because in all this there is a personal element, a very important personal element in the way you work. But I'm pretty sure that in a way or another, they feel very similar to me. So I think that this was a generation, I don't want to say that it was the last, but because this would be unfair with the new people that are working in comics today. But I think that we have a special connection with Marvel Comics and DC Comics. We try to keep the tradition. And I think that in the last years, the comics find the energy in breaking the tradition, in trying to find a new formula, a new way of doing, a new way of penciling, a new way of working with new tools. The tools are totally different. They are not penciled anymore. They are not erasers anymore. there are no paper anymore. Everybody work with digitally, with Cintiq and all this. And this has changed everything. I think that our generation still wanted to keep the flame of the comic, traditional comics. The comic we read when we were children, and this is probably why you find this all energy in our pages.
That actually does make a lot of sense, because, you know, you look at the people who came before you and who you grew up with, people like John Byrne, Neil Adams, Alan Davis, who's still doing a ton of work today. Mm-hmm. I think Alan Davis may actually be a robot, because you look at how much work he does and how long he's been working. I am convinced that Alan Davis is actually a cyborg.
Mm-hmm. 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 Well, so there are complicated days because as I've been saying, so we came from an industry that doesn't exist anymore. So today the comics are in any Marvel or DC comics today, you find formulas that you just found in another kind of comics, in the independent comics, in the comics, underground comics, and European comics. There are a lot of people coming from everywhere. So, and this has changed absolutely the shape of superhero. Superhero is not an American. I'm afraid that superhero is not an American tradition anymore. I think that is an international tradition. Overall, considering the movies has also affected very much to all these. So, well, anyway, I'm very proud I never felt proud of the work I've done. I'm proud of the books I read. I love everything that I read from Alan Davis, as you said, Aaron and Andy, Joe's father. This is what I feel proud to all the things that have been feeding me in superhero comics, more than what I've been doing all those years.
See, and for me, you know, it's like, I can definitely relate, because with my show that I do, mm-hmm. a big part of it was other shows I really admired, and it was their work that made me want to create what I do, and mm-hmm. it's their work that motivates me to just become, to just be better,
oh,
you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, now, you mentioned earlier how you came into X-Men. Now, what was your first published comic book that you did, and how did you get started in comics?
Well, so before being published in the States, I worked briefly for the Spanish market, but not working in comics properly. What I did was to work in the company that translate the Marvel comics and DC Comics in Spain. There were two different companies, and I did for the company that Planeta was the name of that company that published Marvel Comics those days. I started to do posters and covers, variant covers, and I remember that those days Secret Wars 2 was published. And they published this LinkedIn series as a independent book, but containing in the book, containing in the whole series, the tie-ins of all the books like Daredevil, X-Men. So those tie-ins were published two times. One of them inside this the general Secret War books, and in their own book, in their own title. So they needed a different cover, and this is why they asked me to do covers for those special Secret War tie-ins titles. And they became popular, even more popular than I would expect. And they offered me more covers for reprints and doing posters, And at the same time, those days I was the answers the letter call for the DC Comics, and I read the letters from fans that the fans sent to the DC Comics, Batman, Swamp Thing, Alan Moore, Swamp Thing, and Matt Wagner, Demon, and all those comics from the 80s, and I loved it. I the Titans, Mark Wolfman and Tom Grummet, Teen Titans. I love those books, and I was very very happy answering the letters to the fans' letters, and this is what I did in the 80s, and I started in the 90s to work for the American market. And but before that, I can remember this now. Before to work for America, I worked briefly for Marvel UK, and in 1993, if I'm not wrong, I did a book for them named Dark Guard, and my pal Salva La Roca was doing Death's Head, and Pasquale Ferri did Plasma, and we three broke in comic book through Greg Britton working for Marvel UK, and after a year working for them, we three went to, and Oscar Jimenez too. We three went to the States. I started doing working for DC, doing Flash, because the late Mike Waringo needs some rest, and I was very happy doing the Flash issues where Impulse were introduced to the DC universe, and it was very very fun, because in the other side, my Mexican pal Humberto Ramos broke also into comics, and he was the artist for Impulse comic book. So we started together, and we've been friends along those years. And then I moved to Marvel for doing the Bishop miniseries. DC offered me to stay up with them, and I even did a few issues, or Flash issues, after I finished my Bishop miniseries, but I decided to stay at the X office. I thought that it was the best place for being in comics those days, and well, I don't know if it was good or not, but I'm still here, so I think that it was a good decision finally.
I agree. I remember I was actually a big fan of the Mark Waid's Flash. That book was just fantastic.
Yeah.
And I'm so happy that we're finally... Because if you remember the 90s, like, you know, people, audiences nowadays, they go to a store and you have all the graphic novels and trades, volume 1, 2, 3, 4. It's all very easy. But back in the 90s, that wasn't the case. You would have, like, a random collection of, like, 6 issues and hope that you got more. And now we're finally getting complete trades of the Mark Waid Flash. And the work you and Waringo and Ramos did was just absolutely amazing on those books.
Well, it was great. Brian, the editor, Brian Augustine, and Ruben Diaz were such a great guy. So the way they were the editors, Brian was the editor, and Ruben was the assistant, and they treated me so well. So that was very sad for me to say no to DC, because they offered me few things that I would have loved to do. I remember they offered me to do something with Sovereign 7 with Chris Claremont. I'm the big Chris Claremont fan in the world.
Oh, dude, me too.
I love Chris. We've become friends. And finally, we're still trying to have the moment for doing something together. This would be a dream to me to do something with Chris, because I was a big fan of Chris before the X-Men, Yeah, I love Aaron Fest, well, Marvel Team App, and everything that he has done along the years. And also they offered me to do Shazam with Jerry Orway. And I love Jerry. I love the pencils, and especially the inking. To me, Jerry Orway, the George Perez pencils in Crisis, in final issues, in the Crisis final issues, looks so great just because Jerry Orway also put a lot of energy in them, and I love all the people. It was very sad to me to have to say no to that, but I had also to think professionally, and the ex office was the place everybody wanted to be those days, and I took that decision. And I love also Susan Gaffney, who was my editor there, and she was probably the person that helped me the most in all my whole career. I love Suzanne. I'm very thankful to Bob Harris and all the people that work with me those days too.
I was talking to Devin Grayson a little while back, mm-hmm. and we were talking about how the DC offices in the 90s, how like the mid to late 90s, it was just mm-hmm. such an interesting place because you had all these really crazy, talented people just throwing ideas out there constantly. So mm-hmm. you had, like, you know, you guys in Wade on Flash, you had Porter and Morrison on JLA later on, you had her Titans run, you had Chuck Dixon writing everything.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I love Chuck, but he's another one. He's like Alan Davis. I'm convinced that he is a half-robot because no one can do as much as he does.
Mm-hmm. Chuck did a wonderful Batman, so I remember what reading his Batman issues, and it was great. So it was a very, those days I think that we're being unfair with the things that were done in comics those days. So I think that we are a little bit unfair with the 90s, because a lot of good things were done those days. Maybe the 80s are a better decade, just because, well, you know, so the late days of a Gene Shooter were the better in terms of quality and popularity of comics, were maybe the best Marvel comics. So, but apart from that, some things were very well done, and they were big names, and there was the company, the Marvel Comics, were in bankruptcy those days, and financially the things weren't the best one in the world. But apart from that, apart from those troubled times, and the coming of Image also was damage to match to Marvel. But I think that a lot of people did would work those days, and not always, not everything was a garbage, as some people used to say. You know.
You know what I think the big problem is? I think a lot of the people who didn't read those comics are a lot of people saying this, and mm-hmm. really the early 90s were kind of like everyone always talks about, oh, big guns, big tits, and that was the early 90s really. And it kind of tempered out a little bit, and things got a little better. And I think the problem is that people that the like the Young Blood and books like that were so prominent that people mm-hmm. who didn't grow up in that era assume mm-hmm. that all comics were like that in the 90s. They don't realize mm-hmm. how big a variety there actually was.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that today the things are quite different.
Yeah.
We've learned too much about Image and all that, so the hype today is much bigger than I'm talking about Marvel, because Image did a wonderful hype those days. And Marvel Comics have not very clear what to do those days. They didn't know if they should promote artists. Because what we did with the Image generation, they promoting Rob Liefeld, Jim Lee, Tom Marfalan, and all those guys, and finally they left the company and created a new one. So they don't want, Marvel don't want this happening anymore. So, and they stopped promoting and they start promoting the artists, and they start to do the same with just promoting the characters. So, and this meant that you cannot promote the books, the books that the artists were doing, because the names of the artists were in the hype, in the journal hype of all this. So this was very complicated for the sales and Joe, in those terms, Joe Quesada did a great work, because he came with a new energy, a new vision, and he created a great hype for selling, for trying to put Marvel in a prominent position again, and it was very successful doing that. Very, very successful. I think that the main thing Joe did those days was to place Marvel in a prominent, in a relevant industrial and financial position.
I think it was around that time that I started seeing your work on DC coming back, because you were doing Batman, I can't remember if it was Batman, Superman, or Superman, Batman.
JLA, JSA.
Yeah, and then you started doing your work on Superman with Kurt Busiek. Mm-hmm. And with that, I wanted to actually go to one of my favorite comic books, two of my favorite comics you ever worked on, and that was Avengers Forever with Kurt Busiek.
Mm-hmm.
And the kind of almost unknown run around a lot of comic fans, Warren Ellis' Excalibur.
Mm-hmm.
Which I remember because for me, Avengers Forever is one of the best comic books ever made.
Oh. Thank you very much. Avengers Forever was the book I always dreamed to work with. And I was working the X-Men, and I was a little bit, those days, Joe Madureira, you mentioned Joe before. Joe Madureira was so popular, that one day offered me to work in the on X-Men, I was so insecure about my position that my position in the American industry, I meant, and that I wanted to adjust my way of working in comics to this Amerimanga style that was so popular those days. But this was very unnatural to me, because I'm not a big manga fan. I love some manga, particularly the mangas that don't love the people that love manga, you know. But Taniguchi and Masamune Shiro, Otomo, and all that. So I'm not very big fan of Death Note and Naruto and all those.
I love Battle Angel, if you remember thing. Battle Angel.
Mm. I remember perfectly though. I remember perfectly the Kanju. And at the beginning, so like Angel, Alita, Angel of Combat, Combat Angel, and but I'm not, the thing is that I'm not a big manga fan, but I try to adjust my style to this popular style, but I felt so uncomfortable that I wanted to do something new. Those days, I think that those days, right? My contract was about to end, and I have a DC offer, and I told Bob Harris that I was very uncomfortable with the X-Men, and I would, because I love Fantastic Four, I love the Avengers. Everybody wants to do the Avengers today, but back in the 90s. Nobody wanted to do the Avengers. This was the reason why Marvel sold the characters sold in brackets. And Marvel led those characters in the hands of Jim Lee and Rob Liefeld, Jeff Loeb, and Ian Churchill, just in order to revamp the characters, just because nobody wanted to do those characters those days. And those were the characters, exactly the characters I always dreamt of working. And this was, as I said, just after a Heroes Reborn saga. and George Perez was doing the Avengers, and obviously I wasn't crazy enough to say I want to be where George Perez is. So I was the first person in the world absolutely happy seeing George Perez back to the Avengers, because this was one of my favorite books ever. And but Borjara said, don't explain that I love to do the Avengers, but having George Perez in the book, it was impossible because I never will ask for that. He told me that there's no any problem. We can create a new Avengers book. And I was absolutely happy in that moment. He told me, who do you want? What do you want in this book? Which would be your writer for that book? And obviously, I Kurt Busiek. I had any other name in my mind. I remember reading the Marvels with Alex Ross, and this guy is absolutely wonderful. And then I read Thunderbolts, the ending of the issue ones bring me back to the energy of those old Marvel days, and I wanted to work with Kurt. And just Bob told me, let me talk to Kerr, because I'm not if he's busy, very busy or not. He Kerr called me almost immediately, telling me that he read what I did in Marvel UK. He also wanted to work with me, and we both started to work in this Avengers book that initially had nothing to do with Avengers Forever. He was a totally different title, Avengers title obviously, but had nothing to do with the Avengers. We create a parallel world where one of the Rick Jones from the Marvel Universe we all know, Rick Jones went to this parallel universe, Marvel universe, and they discovered that the Nazis governed this war after the Second War, and they rule America, they rule everything, something similar to Earth X in DC Comics. And this was just because Captain America kept frozen in the pole, and Rick Jones needed to go to look for Captain America in order to free America and the whole world. And the idea was so brilliant that I don't know if Kerr is happy knowing that I'm telling this, but I hope he doesn't mind. And the thing is that we prepared everything. Everything was set for starting to work in the title, and then Marvel called us saying that we cannot do that, because the idea was so good that they preferred to do it in an X title, and they created a mutant X. So with Havoc going to another world, you remember? I don't know if you remember this book, and we had to change everything, and we said, okay, let's gonna have some fun. Let's gonna do whatever. Let's gonna choose the character. Let's gonna just having some fun with the Marvel universe, with the Avengers universe, and let's try to put every character we love to include, any character that Kurt loved to draw, any character that I love to to draw, and the thing is that Kurt loved to write about Goliath and Giant Man in this case, and the Wasp, because he was controlling the characters in the book, and he asked me which characters I wanted to include in the book. I loved Captain America from the Steve Englehart and the Watergate days, and I also choose I chose Somber from Thunderbolts. I love the characters. It was a villain, and there were a big tradition of having villains in the Avengers, and they became the sexual element of the story, like Mantis or Scarlet Witch, and I wanted, and I thought that the Sunbird would be perfect for that, and also I chose what was the character? Clint Barton. Okay, from the days when they stopped being Goliath and before becoming Hawkeye again. So I love the designs, I love the characters. I add some elements to the design, to the final design. And Marvel told us that they wanted to revamp Legacy, to transform the character in a new Captain Marvel. And I had no idea how the character looked. When I saw the pages, I found a guy with a long ponytail, white long ponytail and a red jacket. And okay, let's gonna change this. So I asked Marvel if I could change the shape of the character, the design, and go ahead with him. And I create something based on Marlon Brando's in Julio Cesar, and the look of the character. So and finally, we have a new Captain Marvel that I think one of the best designs that I've done, because it's keep the initial Gil Kane who designed on the character with the Jim Starlin element, and again the character looked different, unique, and he has a personal style. So everybody was happy working in this title. Everybody was absolutely happy, and in those 12 issues, we decided to the Western element from the Avengers, and everything that came to our mind was included in the pages of Marvel.
And I gotta say, I didn't know you actually had created that design for Captain Marvel. Because I know you had done that, and then Criss Cross came on with Peter David, like, right after. Mm-hmm. But I was reading them around the same time, because there was a point in time where I stopped reading comics for a while. But, yeah, because I personally never liked the previous design, where he just looked like, what's a good way to put it? He looked like a 90s guy. You know, he had the ponytail and the super jacket.
Yeah, the jackets, the ponytail, so, you know.
It just dated it so much, and... This one, it really felt like something out of, you know, out of the old cosmic stories from the 70s and 80s, and it seemed to fit the look of the character so much more.
So to the character, to the Captain, to Janice, to the Captain Marvel, that we create with the original Captain Marvel song, and I wanted to be very respectful, because... to me, one of the best superhero designs were done by Gil Kane, and Gil, except Spider-Man, to me is probably the best one. Gil Kane did Captain Marvel. He did also Green Lantern, and I had the chance of working with the two characters, and I tried to be very respectful with Gil's work, and I never wanted to fix what it wasn't broken, and to me the Gil Kane design for Captain Marvel was perfect, and just the underwear to the lady underwear, to eliminate the underwear on the characters in order to adjust him to the new era, but keeping the whole design. And I did basically the same with the Green Lantern. They asked me to change, the DC guys asked me to change the character as much as I wanted, and I didn't want to change anything, just eliminate the underwear and the underpants and keep with the same design. To me, Gil is one of the best artists I ever met, and well, I don't want to change the thing. I don't want to change the status, because one thing is, when you're being here reading comics since 4 years, one thing that you learn is that everything that is changed radically will be eliminated sooner or later, and the things will be back in the way they were. So let's keep on doing the things that way, and let's try to do the best, but respecting the work of the people that have been here before us. So this is my way of understanding this fucking job.
I think it's because of that mentality that you have as an artist, and as it is, and with that respect that you have for the people, the classic creators, is why your work has always had this really cool balance where it seems like you have one foot in the modern and you have mm-hmm. one foot in the world of the classic. And mm-hmm. I think that is why when you look at some of the artists, you know, some artists who, you know, who they would go too far. They would say, let's make everything extreme ponytails. Mm-hmm. And I never had that with your work, especially as you said, as you worked in more work that you were more comfortable in, less of the manga and more of the work like Avengers, more of the work in Avengers Forever and Superman. Mm-hmm. And it really always, and it always gave, it gives kind of a timelessness to your work. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of that comes from you having that one foot in the classic and that one foot in the modern.
Well, anyway, I consider absolutely necessary to have a good bunch of artists with an open mind to new formulas, with new way of understanding comics, because this is what create the future possibilities. I remember that the day that Marvel Comics was created, the comic that Stan Lee did those days, the comic that from Jim Collan, from Gil Kane, from Romita, from Steve Ditko, from were absolutely a brand new way of understanding comics. Had nothing to do with the shape that the comics had before them, and I still consider absolutely necessary to having a new guys that open new ways for working on comics. I remember the coming of someone like Bill Sienkiewicz. Bill is probably one of the greatest artists in this business ever. But sometimes these new formulas are so personal that it makes no sense to go after this way, to take this way for going ahead. Who want to imitate Bill Sienkiewicz? It makes no sense. It's so great, so personal, so impossible to. It's not a formula. It's art. It's not a formula. So he has done something bigger than keeping the industry. He had transformed a part of an industry into a art, and this is something wonderful. But also there is another part of the this business that is industry, and in this part we have to, as you said, we have to put a foot on the tradition and a foot in trying to find new ways for the future. But this is a slower way, this is a lower road. But this is I always thought that this is the way that is the pillar of the industry. If this pillar don't exist, the comics won't sell as much as is needed in order to have a strong industry that allows itself to having artists like Sienkiewicz, or like Matt Wagner, or like, you know, those kind of artists that that have the real artists of this industry.
Yeah.
I don't know if all that I think makes sense, but in my mind have a lot of sense, you know.
Exactly. I completely understand what you mean. Something I wanted to mention, you brought up Green Lantern, mm-hmm. and something that I've noticed, I don't know if you've, you know, because as an artist, you know, you're doing, you're working on all these titles, but I've noticed that with you, you've become a part of so many of these, like, just really strong classic runs. Like Avengers Forever, like we said, is still considered one of the best Avengers stories ever published. And then you come into Geoff Johns' Green Lantern, which even after the New 52, which I'm not going to say my opinion of, I'm going to be very polite and not say how I feel about New 52 right now. But like your guys working on Green Lantern was so good that they did not touch it. Yeah, you know, they just let the run continue. And what was it like working on that character? What was it like working on such a substantial book that had such an impact on modern comics?
Well, the thing is that talking about Green Lantern, well, the thing is that after Avengers Forever, I did Fantastic Four, and I needed to being a DC fan too. While working with Marvel characters, you know, while working with those toys, you wanted also to play with the toys that were at the top shelves, you know, so that you can get to handle them. And then after being 8 years working for Marvel, I decided to move to DC. Particularly because also the Marvel was in this transition, as we're talking with Joe Quesada, a rival, and Joe also was very, very, very kind, talking to me in San Diego, and we having lunches and talking about the possibility of going back to Marvel. But as I said, so I wanted to play with DC characters. And I thought that it was the best moment for doing that, and the Green Lantern, it was as I said before, it was a big responsibility, but also was very fun because Green Lantern again was a character nobody wanted to do those days. The book was canceled, and there were no any Green Lantern book in the market. The characters appear in the Justice League, but John Stewart in John Stewart incarnation, but then there were no title, the Green Lantern title those days, and the thing was that Jesus Merino, my friend Jesus, were very very close. We shared the nights working and pages. I was penciling while he was thinking, and you know, in one of the breaks moment in order to have some coffee, one of stupid conversations about Kirby, about Steve Ditko, about everything. So we and he told me, Carlos, what characters would you hate the most in the DC universe? Which character do you never would like to do? It's, apart from Aquaman. Obviously, because nobody wanted to do Aquaman those days. Today is very popular, but not those days. The Joe was the underwater criminality was bigger enough for having a superhero that act in the seas, in the oceans. So the thing is that I said that maybe Green Lantern, because I thought that everything was done, everything with the character was done with Neil Adams and Danny O'Neill. They play with Green Lantern and Green Arrow in a Easy Rider tradition, that in the Easy Rider movie formula, and they traveling to America, knowing the problems of America those days. But there were no real stories about Green Lantern. And we started to talk. Very much, and then we have some a big idea about the Green Lantern universe. We thought that we never understood why the universe, all the planets of this universe, accept the moral rules of a white Anglo-Saxon American as Hal Jordan. Why an alien from another civilization with totally morals, with totally different morals, with totally different ethics. Why this guy had to accept the Hal Jordan ethics and the way of acting. And the idea was to create a schism inside the Green Lantern Corps. But no bad guys. No bad guys versus good guys. A schism between good guys, because the guy that didn't want to accept those moral formulas didn't consider himself a bad guy. He was the hero of his planet. He was a hero, the best guy in his planet was so good that he had a Green Lantern ring. And this idea was growing up in our mind. And one day in San Diego, we were to a dinner, and I was talking with one of the DC guys, and I said, he told me that, okay, it's Carlos, Geoff Johns, I was so happy of doing the JLA, JSA graphic novel with you, that he would love to do something with you again. So, and I said, okay, let's go and do Green Lantern. And everybody was freezing at the moment. And Geoff Johns was in a few feet behind us. And someone told Geoff, Carlos want to do Green Lantern with you. But Geoff came running immediately. And what are you saying? So I would like to do, would you like to accept to do a new Green Lantern title? And he took his phone, called Dan Didio. And deal, and then Carlos, would you accept to having me and Carlos Pacheco in a Green Lantern book? He hung up. He told me he want to have breakfast with us, with both of us tomorrow morning, in order to talk about the revamping of Green Lantern. And this was so exciting because everything happened in such a stupid way. Having coffee with Jesus Marino at 4:05. That was so great. That was a race. So, and then, and suddenly we have a new Green Lantern back, Hal Jordan back to the DC universe in a moment. So, and they told me that they needed to having Hal Jordan first, and then we'll have the title. And and this is what the things were done. So they create the return of Hal Jordan in a miniseries, and then they get me the new title. And I did something that just a few people realize. When I did the cover of Green Lantern, the issue one, I did a design, a cover design that had not the name of Green Lantern on the cover. I told them that this was the best way of showing the world that DC trusts so much in the character that they were bold enough of having a book without the name of the character on the cover. Just the mask, the chest symbol, and the ring, and the green, the color ring, invading everything. And they were a little bit scared at the beginning, but they accept the idea. And I think that the cover worked so well that nobody noticed that the name of the character wasn't included in the issue one cover.
I literally only noticed now. Like, I looked at it while you were talking about it, and I'd never noticed.
Yeah.
You're completely right.
So take a glance to the cover, and you'll see that there were no the Green Lantern name on this, because I don't know if I'm revealing some confidential information, but to DC, the third character, at least those days, today the things have maybe have changed. I'm sure the things have changed today. The third character was Green Lantern. Never was Wonder Woman. The Wonder Woman was a character that was placed in the third position just because they fit very well in terms of Trinity and the Trinity concept. But in popularity, the third character in the Marvel, in the DC universe, always was Green Lantern, and they wanted to have Green Lantern and in the shops, in the stores. And I'm really very proud of helping to the revamping of the book. And I think that Geoff Johns did for a while one of the best superhero comics in of their time, of the time. Geoff has done such a wonderful work in superheroes, with superheroes that nobody wanted. Justice Society, which one of my favorite books ever. Yeah. The original one, so I mean, and Green Lantern, and
his work on Flash and Teen Titans. These were books that no one heard of.
The Titans after, with Mike McCone, was also wonderful, and I consider him one of the best writer and the best superhero writers, because you know there are two kind of writers in superhero. There are writers that have his personal idea, and they apply those ideas. It doesn't matter the book they work on. They have his own idea, and they include the characters of the book they are working in this story. And this is, those are one kind of artist, and there are another kind of writers, which are Geoff Johns, maybe is one of the best, the most relevant writers of this way of understanding comics, that are the ones that listen to the characters. Okay, so what's happening to you? Can you explain me what you have done? What happened to you? And the story comes from the characters to the writer, not to the writer to the characters. And I love to work with this second kind of writers, the writers that listen to the characters and know the story of the characters. And because I love to, if I buy a particular superhero book, I want to read what's happening with this, the biography of this superhero. I don't want to read the ideas that this particular writer has about the world or whatever. I want to read this superhero biography. If I want to read a graphic novel, I buy a graphic novel. I love any personal independent book. But when I buy a superhero, I want to read about the superhero.
Yeah, because, like, this is my opinion just as a fan. You know, because I've done some writing on the side, not a lot, but the stories, the best stories are those that come within the context of the character. They fit naturally. Mm-hmm. And if you're trying to force a story on the character, mm-hmm. like, I know it's a popular story, but a story that I don't particularly like is Identity Crisis. And for me, it felt like a story where they were trying to push this overly dark story that didn't really belong into mm-hmm. a world of superheroes, where with Infinite Crisis, it felt like a story that came from the characters. And because of that, that's why I believe that between the two, Infinite Crisis really has stood the test of time and is still loved. And people have drastically changed their views on Identity Crisis.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was talking about... I can understand what you're saying about Identity Crisis, but it's strange. But sometimes I found that some books contain stories that you can switch the characters.
Yes.
To other one, and the story will be exactly the same because the lead characters of the title are just people that were walking around. But they are not belong to the story. I don't know if I can explain this properly.
That's perfect, actually.
But I don't understand this kind of books. I prefer to read, as you said, those generation, those writers like Mark Waid, Kurt Busiek, Geoff Johns, people that the stories cannot be done with another character, but with the one that are the lead characters of the title that are working on. So this is the way I understand superhero comics. Not the way I understand comics, the way that I understand superhero comics.
And I think it's because I think the reason that people like Wade, Busick, Perez, Claremont, Perez is an artist, but you understand what I mean. The reason that they've stood the test of time so well is because of that obvious love for the characters, and it shines through in these stories.
But also, I found artists, writers, that also shown in his work this love for the characters. I remember that one of the best modern writers that I've worked with is Jonathan Hickman. I love Jonathan. I had the chance of doing the Ultimate Thor for him, and that was to me one of the best titles I had the chance of. I had the chance of working on, and to me the script was so great. There is just a couple of minor things that I thought that they were a sort of fun wonking. Like the idea of having was very great having Loki looks like Simo to Himmler in his meeting with Himmler, because he had not the need the needing of being disguised as Simo, because Himmler had no idea who Loki is, and Loki also might look like any person in the world, so that there was no a real need of being in this disguise. But to me everything apart from that, because this is a very minor thing, just a stupid geek idea to me, the vision, a geek vision that I have is to me this ultimate script from Jonathan Hickman has been one of the best script I had the chance to work with. And also Mark Millar in the Ultimates. Mark is not as modern as Jonathan, but he's probably the best superhero stuff done in the last 20 years. Had the Mark Millar name on the credits. I'm not if I'm saying too much, saying that to me Mark Millar is the Stan Lee of the modern times.
I can see that.
Because the idea that he have been putting in the superhero has been greatest that life, and he understands superhero wonderfully. He from the what he did with the Flash. With Grant Morrison and Paul Ryan, it was absolutely great, but also any of the books that he have done for Marvel and his personal universe is great. He's a mastermind in all this.
I remember I got to talk to Mark a little bit, because Mark is so busy. Like, he is like everywhere. And I got to talk to him a little bit right before Kick-Ass came out. And it was about the Superman the Animated Series, because remember he started on like one of his first books he did was the Superman Adventures, and he was saying that they didn't have Superman the Animated Series in Scotland, like they weren't showing it, so he didn't know anything about the cartoon, because I think he was still in Scotland at the time, and so he was when he was writing the book, he wasn't writing Superman cartoon stories. He was writing just all the Superman stories that he wanted to read, that he wanted to. He never even thought of it as him writing for a children's book. And it reminded me of what you said about when you first started working on comics in Spain, and it was very similar to that, in my opinion.
Trying to summarize everything about Mark, is that the Ultimates, though the Ultimates are a step beyond the authority this sort of evolution of the authority concept that was created by Warren Ellis. But Mark also worked in the authority. And the Ultimates is the Fantastic Four issue one. Authority issue, Ultimates issue one is the Fantastic Four issue one of Modern Time. The Ultimates has changed radically the way of working with superheroes. Today, superheroes are no vigilants anymore. They are a sort of military force. And this all comes from Mark Millar mind in Ultimates. And there are two milestones in American comics, in superhero comics, and today that mark the way of the comics should be done. And those milestones are, to me, are Ultimates and Civil War, because Civil War shows that today the personal identity of the characters are not so important that it was in the past, and the books, the people don't buy the books in order to know about the biography of the characters like we did when we bought, for example, Stan Lee and John Romita's Spider-Man. We bought the book just because knowing that will happen with Mary Jane or Gwen Stacy and Peter Parker. And we prefer to read about this instead of reading about Spider-Man and the Green Goblin. And we thought this book like a sort of Archie comic, modern Archie comic. And but today this has no more interest anymore. This is not catch the interest of the new fans. I think that the comics should show the big events. Big events where the identity of the characters is are put aside, are not as important like the interaction about the characters itself. And I think that Civil War is the last word about this. The Ultimates and Civil War are the two books that have changed. Not change, that mark the way of doing superhero today, and all those two books come from Mark Millar mind and respect mind. He's a real creative force today.
So something I wanted to ask you about, I lost my words for a minute. Something I want to touch on, because we've talked about all this work that you've done. Mm-hmm. In your opinion, what do you think consider your best work? And if you had any book that you could go back to and kind of reevaluate now, what would it be?
My best work? I don't know if you'd be surprised. To me, my best work might be The Inhumans miniseries that I did with Jose Ladron back in the 1999, I think. I love what I did in this book with my friend Rafael Marin. I love what we did with the characters. I think that we gave the characters the cosmic scope the characters always deserved, and they spend their lives before this miniseries. They spend their lives hidden in a black dome, or going to the moon, or trying. But like the Inhumans were the Inhuman Atilan was a sort of city of Kandor from Marvel. So people inside the battle, nobody can go out except the royal family. And maybe this is because the fascination, the American fascination for monarchy, I don't know why. Maybe because I always thought that in America there is a fascination about France, and about kings, about the royalty. And France is a republic, as American. The United States and France are the most modern, the first republics from the modern times. And I understood why a civilization like the humans are governed under the dictates of a monarchy. The royal family, the Inhumans' royal family, who they are, why they govern the Inhumans, why the Inhumans upset to be controlled by a monarchy, and this is what I did in this book, to work with the basis of the Inhumans' status. And I don't know if you remember, but the end of the title, the Inhumans upset his Kree legacy, the Kree legacy that they always had in his DNA, and they upset to go to the stars with the Kree and accept his destiny.
Yeah.
And instead of be hidden in an obscure corner of the earth, just because the Black Bolt dictates that. And I introduced a couple of characters that were almost forgotten. Ronald Accuser, and which has become very relevant in the Inhumans universe today. And the other one was Star-Lord, because I always love Star-Lord, always love the characters. I read it when Stephen O'Hara created and Steve Gann created, but I always my first, always considered one of my first book ever read, the one that Chris Claremont, John Byrne, and Terry Austin did when Star Wars came to the world way back in 1977. And this Star-Lord was so modern, so great, that I always wanted to see him in the Marvel Universe. I remember that John Byrne did some jokes with the twins, the evil twins, in one of the, putting them in the backgrounds of one of the panels in the X-Men. And this gave me the idea, oh man, Star-Lord should be in the Marvel Universe. And I also followed the joke in the Starjammers miniseries. I drew one of the evil twins in the final last page of this Starjammers miniseries, and then I decided to include Star-Lord in one way or another in the Marvel Universe. I put I work with Peter Quill father, Jason Quill, and I became the first Star-Lord, and the character appeared with the sentient ship in the pages of this Inhuman miniseries. And to me, maybe this Inhumans book is one of the books I love the most. And in terms of art, Arrowsmith is my favorite book, maybe because I was free enough of putting other artistic influences from European comics, and not just to adjust a book my style to the superhero genre. I felt with the liberty, with the freedom of playing with my John Giraud, Uderzo influences on the book, European influences, and in this one, I have a lot of time for doing the book, also for working on it, and I'm very proud of those two books, Inhumans and Arrowsmith.
Unfortunately, I didn't get to read Inhumans, but now I really want to. And I'm pretty sure a lot of our viewers who haven't got to read it are going to go check it out.
Jose Ladrón hizo... I was about to speak in Spanish. Jose Ladrón did that wonderful, wonderful, wonderful work. So different from any other Marvel book you ever seen. So, and this is the reason why Jose is now working with Jodorowsky on expanding the Moebius in Cal universe, because his vision about technology, alien races, pages compositions, and in terms of comic grammar, Jose Vision was absolutely. I adore Jose.
I love Hip Flask.
Yeah.
Yeah, Hip Flask was one of those things I never thought would. It's one of those books, like, you go back and read it, and it's like, how did this come out? You know, because it doesn't seem like something that would. And then you read it, it's such a great work by him and Starskins.
I understand perfectly when Richard Starkins talked me about the Hip Flash with Jose, so Jose is the perfect. It was a shame because I would have liked to keep on working with Jose in this turn of writer and penciler. But he wanted to move to the French market in one way or another. He did Hip Flash, and he was a tryout for working for the Humanoids and the Jodorowsky in Cal and Universe, and he did it successfully. And he has been, I don't know if he's keep on working on with Jodorowsky again. But what he did with Inkal is a book that any comic fan should read. It's fantastic.
I was to say so.
I don't know if it's stupidity, but I love Jose Inkal as much as I love Moebius Inkal.
Oh wow!
Yep.
Because Moebius, like, he was just amazing.
Moebius is Moebius, obviously. It's Moebius, but yeah. Jose is Jose too.
Yep. But there's a comic store. Like, I live about an hour away from Austin, and there's a comic store here, where literally they have everything. It's called Austin Books and Comics. They have the albums from France. They have comics from. They have comics from Spain, from England, everywhere. They have comics from all over the world. And it is four stores in one. Like, you go, they have an art, little, like, art gallery, an area that you can go in, and they have, like, Milo Manera's book. They have Manera's books. They have, like, the full art books laid out on the table so you can look at them right there. And it's just this fantastic store. And you would just pass it by and think it was this little tiny comic book store. And then you go in there and you realize just how much there is and how much of a passion there is throughout that business. If you're ever in Austin, you need to go to Austin Books and Comics. It is possibly the best store I've ever been to.
Good. That's good, because one thing that have changed, the comic shape has changed so much lately just because the world has become smaller. In the 70s, it was almost impossible to find easily comics from other part of the world. The American comics were popular in the rest of the world, particularly superheroes, but we also can find Robert Crumb or Gilbert Shelton, Spain Rodriguez, Richard Corbin, independent comics, you know. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that it was very difficult in the 70s to find, in America, to find comics for other part of the world. And the thing is that all this has changed. Just take a glance to the Eisner Awards, and you see that, for example, Juanjo Guarnido, my friend Juanjo, is getting the with Black Sat, is having as much, isn't it, other words as possible. David Aja working on Hawkeye. And there are so many people today working in from any part of the world, working in the States. And this is not just because we know, the people from other countries know about American comics. It's because the American fans are open their minds to a new way of doing comics. Superhero comics were too endogamic for a while, and they repeat some formulas that work very well, the big names on this, but it was a closed universe on itself. it was reactive to other way of working. This was this the in 70s Marvel worked with different styles, but not in superheroes itself. But I remember, I don't know, Shang-Chi or the Tomb of Dracula or Killer Raven, or even DC later with Swamp Thing, Demon, Watchmen. But has been a graduation, has been a slow transformation of the shape of the industry, of the American industry. And we are now in a point where the American market is open to admit totally brand new formulas. And you, if you pay attention to the comic that Marvel is doing today, they are so different. They are so totally different from the idea that the old fans had about Marvel comics, that I understand that some of them would be even angry with that. But this is the new world, man. We better to accept it, because this is how the world is today. The world is smaller. The people learned about other cultures, other way of understanding comics, and they are not American comics anymore. I don't know if Donald Trump is happy to listen to that, but the comics is an international business today that has its base on in America, in the States. But the people that at Marvel and the people at DC are smart enough of knowing that they are dealing with a mythology, with a mythology that is easy to understand in any part of the world, in any culture of the world, and they has become bigger than they ever expect. Maybe I always thought that the superheroes were an American tradition, and they were an American tradition, but today it's a world tradition, and this is very good for America. It's very good for superhero comics, but cannot be done in the old way, in the way that we loved. Should be done in a totally different way. Fortunately, the old way is still alive, and there are some books, some titles that can be done in that old fashion. Fortunately, I said fortunately because I consider one of those old fashioned guys, but and I hope to be in this industry until the last days of my life, and I hope that the new formulas don't eliminate the old ones, and I think that we have room for any way of understanding superhero and understanding comics today, but we have to accept that the old fans has to accept the new ones, and the new fans has to accept the old ones, and to create a cohesive thing and the sum is bigger than the parts.
I completely agree. Two more questions before we before we bring the show to a close. Yeah. What advice would you give people trying to work in the comics today? Because it is difficult. You know, it is difficult to break in. And what new projects do you have coming out? Where can we find your work?
So the advice that I will give to the new people is that don't accept advices. Don't accept advices, because the advices from the people that the old artists can give to the new one. Maybe the way of working, the way of understanding the comics has nothing to do with the new market, with the new formula. So learn too much. Learn as much as possible, draw as much as possible, be familiar with the tools, practice with the tools, and don't accept advices. Particularly if the people say that you cannot be an artist. I've listened this too much when I was a kid, and I finally became an artist. So practice, learned about grammar, comic grammar, read books about comics, and find your own way. And this is the way of being here. The best way of accepting, of having receiving advices, is absorbing all the advices the artists that have been here before have been putting in the pages of the comics they have done before. In those comics are all the advices any artist need for breaking into comics and be popular in comics. Learn from them and don't accept any other kind of advices. And the projects that I'm working today, so this looks like if I were doing some hype saying that Inhumans was my favorite book, because today I'm working with Inhumans, with Charles Soule. I was absolutely honest when I mentioned the Inhumans one as one of my favorite books. But I'm also very happy working with this new Inhumans. Has nothing to do with Inhumans that I work in the past. And it's almost a brand new title with brand new characters. But this title belongs to the new Marvel, and I'm very happy of being a part of the new Marvel. So totally happy of being with those characters again, Medusa, Karnak, and Black Bolt, and all that, and those new characters that appear in the book too.
All right, and with that, where can people find you on this wonderful, wonderful place called the Internet?
Oh. Well, so I don't know. So I would say torrent, but I don't know if I'm very, if Margaret would be happy if I mentioned that.
See, that's what we say, DeviantArt instead.
I don't know. So I'm still one of those guys that love to go to the stores to smell comics. And I don't check the web very much for buying comics and to locate comics. So I'm still one of those guys that love to go to the store, to the comic store, and to see what is the new comic in the struggles of the week, and talk to the people there and you know, see how the fans hate and love the people there that are working comics. And still, my best advice is go to the store and buy the comics and socialize a bit. The other things that to be isolated in your house buying comics by internet, and this is the best way of becoming a mutant. So
the and not the cool kind that have like that can have claws in their hands, but like the sad kind that look like a lumpy potato.
Oh, that's right. Oh my.
Oh. But
that's really funny.
we were at another show, and we were talking about how there was a recent article that said that comic books, the great thing about them, like what you said, they said that 80% of the sales were through physical, were like the actual comic books. And I think that's so great that with a you know, market that's gone so towards digital with everything, that with comics, the vast majority is still physical sales and still physical comics. And I think that's fantastic.
It's that for me, the comics is a physical thing. I love to work with paper, and I use Cintiq and for transform the pages that I've done physically. But to me, I need the physical contact. I need the physical contact with the page, with the tools, with pencils. And I still, as I told you, so I still need to smell the paper, the comic, and to be impact for the comics in more than visually and intellectually, to feel that they are a physical thing, and not just a ethereal digital thing. So I'm too old-fashioned, but you know, so this is who I am.
I'm the same way. Like, if you come in, like, my home/studio, like, the first thing you see when you walk in, this wall of just trades, graphic novels, hardcovers, just absolutes, like, just all the things that I love right there. Because I've tried reading a digital comic. It's boring. Mm-hmm. And it's so much more exciting to have it right there with you.
Yeah. Well, so this is my general vision about this. Also, I'm sorry too much about my English. I don't know if it's good enough for being understood.
It definitely is.
I'm trying to do my best with that, and it's too late at night. Right now, it's 4:30 a.m.
I'm so sorry.
I'm sorry. I'm totally happy being with you, but I'm so fortunate of being talking with the American fans, because I don't have this chance very much. I talk too much for the European fans, but sometimes I felt a bit far from the American community, you know, creative community, because yeah. Living in Europe, so you don't have the chance. Fortunately, the Facebook and Twitter and all these helped very much to having some contact with the fans from America. But I really appreciate this chance. It doesn't matter if it's too late. I mentioned the time just because I'm too tired. And I don't know if I'm doing properly, but I really appreciate the chance of spending some time talking about comics with you, because comics is so important to me that I think that you notice that I love to talk about comics.
Definitely, and I love
even in English.
And I absolutely loved having you on the show. Thank you so much for doing this.
My pleasure. It's a total pleasure.
And with that, we are going to bring the newest episode of Geeks4Comics to a close. I'm Ian McIntosh. This is our special guest, Carlos Pacheco. Thank you, everybody, so much for listening. And just keep on reading comics, especially the ones that Carlos draws.
And don't download comics from Torrent. That's a joke. I didn't. Ian, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure, man.
Thank you. You have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
You've been listening to Circuit 42, brought to you by Dragon's Lair San Antonio and Gotham Newsstand. Join us for our next episode for All Things Geek.
Circuit 42.